I'm Dr. Parvez Ahmed. In this lecture, we will talk about the ionization chamber. What is an ionization chamber? As you know that last time, we have defined that ionization chamber is one of the gas field detector or gas field sensor. Remember that this kind of the chamber, this kind of the radiation detector is one of the simplest of all the gas field radiation detectors. So this kind of the radiation detectors, this kind of radiation detector we apply in electric field are equal to 10 raised to the power 4 volt per meter to collect all the ionization produced by the incident radiations and the gas volume. I mean, later on in these lectures, we will have a brief mechanism, a brief diagrammatic mechanism of how the radiations produce the ion pair and what is the role of the applied voltage. So we say that here we should have applied field. I mean, this kind of radiation detector work with the applied field equal to this much to collect the ionization produced by the incident radiations. So it should be remembered that in most ionization chamber, the gas between the electrode is air. I mean, it's the most simple. It's for the simplicity. I mean, we can use the inert gases as well, just like we mentioned for the gas field detector when we were having a general introductions. But we can use the air as well. We can use the argon, we can use the helium, but you can also use the air. So the chamber may or may not be sealed from the atmosphere. Why it shouldn't be? Because if you want to utilize the air, so this why, I mean, we can say that the chair may or may not be sealed from the atmosphere. Why is that? It's because that we have to utilize the air, and we want to detect the radiations from the atmosphere. So this the reason is why we say that it sure or shouldn't be seen from the atmosphere. There are many different designs for the electrode and the ionization chamber, but usually they consist of a wire inside a cylinder or a pair of concentric cylinders. I mean, it means that the ionization chambers, it comes in a variety of shapes and structure. So most commonly we say that it consists of a wire inside of cylinders or a pair of concentric cylinders. So how it look like? I mean, this is the ideal shapes of the ionization chamber. That is, initially we have a cylindrical shape, and that cylindrical shapes we have two electrodes. That is the anode and the cathode, and both of these anode and cathode, we have already mentioned that they have their respective functions. Both of these electrodes, they are collected, they are connected with the high voltage source. So what we have here inside this chamber, I mean, this is the chamber between these two electrodes. So here we have the gas field. I mean, the gas, as we mentioned earlier, the gas should be air or maybe an argon or helium gas. So what we have the radiations from the outside. So when the radiations, when we have the incoming radiations, so this radiation produced the ion pair. What's the ion pair? Like you can see it, we have light green and light blue. So light green is positive ion, that you can see that when we have the radiations, the incoming radiations, so the positive and the negative ion pair, they are being produced. So here you can see that the positive ion pair, which is being labeled by green color, light green color, they are accelerated toward the anode when we have the applied voltage between the electrode. And the negative ions, which we have shown here with the light blue color, is moving toward the positive electrode. that we call the anode. So what we have as a result of this, I mean, when the ion pair has been produced, and with the help of the applied high voltage, they are moving toward the respective electrode. So we have current in the circuit, and this current is being sensed by the electrometer we have in the circuit. So like you can see that here, this is a typical electrometer in the circuit. So it gives us the value of that particular current which has been produced as a result of the incoming radiations. So what do we have? We have that the response is proportion to the ionization rate. That is, what we have, the more ionizations we have, the more sensitivity the detector will have. That's why we're saying that the response, the actions are the reactions of this detectors is proportions to the action of the incoming radiations. That is the activity exposure. The activity are the exposure rate. So this is some sort of the general setup, general mechanism of ionization chamber. So here we have some general properties of ionization chamber, which is that this kind of the radiation sensor, it should have high accuracy. It has higher accuracy. In this kind of detectors, it's stable, and but it's one drawback is it's relatively low. It has relatively low sensitivity. So practically, if you want to see ionization chamber, so these are some of the ionization chambers, ionization detectors that you can see in the market. You can say that these are the already made ionization detectors being practically used in different technologies for sensing of radiations. So these are some of the ionizations detectors that are practically available in the market on the commercial scales. So what are the application of the ionization chamber? If you have ionization chamber or ionization detectors, so what are the application? What you can do with this? So if you have an ionization chamber and you want to operate that ionization chamber in the current mode, so you can utilize this for radiation survey. You can utilize this for as a radiation source calibrators. In addition, you can utilize this as a radioactive gases measurement. I mean, this is when you have an ionization chamber and you want to have these kind of the applications. That is radiation survey, radiation source calibrators, radioactive gases measurement. So you better operate this kind of detectors at current mode. But you have other applications like counting or ALPA spectroscopy. So in that particular case, you have to operate the ionization chamber in a false mode. I mean, if you want to have the application of ionization chamber for counting or for ALPA spectroscopy, so in that particular case, you have to operate that in false mode. Some of the general property of the ionization chambers include high accuracy. I mean, that it's giving the measurements that it's provide is highly accurate. I mean, the sensing capability is high accurate. At the same time, it's stable. I mean, it's not easily damaged by the incoming radiation, so it can work for a longer duration of time. One thing we can say about this, it may be counted as a drawback, but here we are mentioning as a property. It's relatively this kind of radiation that have relatively low sensitivity. So what are the main problems which are associated with the ion chamber or ionization chamber ionization detector? So a basic problem with the ionization chamber is that they are quite inefficient as a detector for X-ray and a gamma rays. That is, If you have the ion beam chamber, ionization chamber, and you want to utilize that for the X-ray and gamma rays detection, so be remember, in that particular case, it's an excellent choice. So you have to choose another detector, which we will discuss later on in a few more lectures. So this kind of detector, it's insufficient for the detection of the X-rays and gamma rays. So what else we have? Why it is insufficient for the detection of X-rays and gamma rays? Because only a very small percentage. How much small? Less than 1% of X-ray or gamma rays passing through the chamber actually interact with and cause ionization of the air molecule. I mean, in point number first, we were mentioning that the ion chamber or the ionization chamber is not a good choice for the X-ray or gamma rays detections. And point number two, we are mentioning the reason that's why it's inefficient. So we are saying that this kind of detector has a very small percentage. How much small? Smaller, less than 1%. And again, we are specifying the reason that X-ray or gamma rays passing through the chamber actually interact with and causing ionization of air molecule. So what we are meaning by this point, what we mean to say is that the interactions between the X-ray or the gamma rays and the air molecule is very, very low. I mean, it's the interaction is not that much. The required rates or the required efficiency for the ionization chamber. So that's why we cannot utilize or we say that it's not a good choice for sensing the X-rays or gamma rays. So what you have for X-rays and gamma rays, their response changes with the photon energy. Why is that? Because photon absorptions and the gas volume. I mean, you are mentioning again the reasons that why this kind of detector is insufficient for the X-ray and gamma rays. So one of the reason is that for X-rays and gamma rays, their response changes with the photon energy. I mean, the response is related with the photon energy. Why? Because photon absorption and the gas volume, most of the photon they are being absorbed in the gas volume. So that's why we have this kind of thing happening for the ion chamber. So detection efficiency and relative penetration of the photon through the chamber walls, both are energy dependent forces. So all these features that results in low detections for the X-rays and gamma rays. So these are some of the problem when you have the ionization chamber and you want to utilize it for the X-rays or the gamma rays, you should keep this point in your mind that these are some of the drawbacks associated with the ion chamber. If you want to utilize that for X-ray or gamma rays, so you should know about these points in order to avoid any inconvenience. So I think it's all for this lectures. In the last lecture, we will talk about the proportion counter and other radiation detector. So till then, it's okay.